stubborn. I can't walk by faith. Every day I wake up to some brand new hate. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants stuff. It's on everybody's top. All these stars that I weather, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants stuff. It's on everybody's top. I beat a case cause I wouldn't talk. You heard that side of the story, but that shit was false. The only ones that want revenge is the ones that lost. I got niggas mad at me cause I wouldn't cross. Solid as they come. You niggas ain't bust shit, how long you had that gun? Why I'm getting so much hate, I ain't mad at them. But they feelings nice up, I threw a bag at them. Damn, had to turn my thug up. Had to put my love up. Cause I don't know who hate no more. They say I'm dead, I don't even wanna wait no more. I'm a stubborn. I can't walk by faith. Every day I wake up to some brand new hate. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. It's on everybody's top. All these stars that I weather, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. It's on everybody's top.
My mama stop her. See my cousin down, sell my face, I couldn't help. Your close homie, I'll try to backdoor you if you love him. I just sent the text 150 if you catch him. Strength. You ever been on the side of the barrel? You tell your shorties going slide, you gotta prep them on. And when you fall out with your brothers, just don't let them go. And they ain't telling before he died, I wish I let them know. Standing over your body, I got my tears together. I just let you know I got your kids forever. Taking all these drugs, wish I could live forever. I ain't gon' even tell them what we did together.
My mama stubborn, I can't walk by faith. Every day I wake up to some brand new hate. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. It's on everybody's top. All these stars that I weather, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. It's on everybody's top. Damn, had to turn my thug up. Had to put my love up. Cause I don't know who hate no more. They say I'm dead, I don't even wanna wait no more. All these stars that I weather, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. It's on everybody's top.
We Japanese still. You getting cooked in front of your family like a Japanese meal. It's y'all soup the hibachi and none of you niggas can stop me, but can't help but watch me. As promised, you know, with a channel, with a group, with a people that get things done. We're here to accomplish. And actually on my channel, I do educate. All these other channels like Sonetta, Garfield, and a lot of these BHI channels is just all about indoctrination, and we try to be to the best of our ability about education. So we're here to give you guys the material, to share the source material, and hopefully someone's edified and you learn about history instead of hearing, you know, a lot of these empty rhetoric videos. We actually provide something of value here at Genesis 49. Is Yap Gang in the building. I see you guys are ready for this chapter. We are going to be dealing with the blade weapons trade. He said catching everybody phase. So we will be dealing with it today, and we'll be knocking out chapter 4 and 5. Yes, it takes time. This is a continuation from yesterday. We're going to complete, well, get 4 and 5 out, and then we have 6 in the conclusion, and we'll see what we do from there. I really want to finish this book, and as promised, I'm finishing the book. We finish books here, man. We all about literacy, bro. We're all about pro literacy here. Yap Gang in the building. Y'all know how we rocking, man. And also have again a sponsor, something from my sponsor that I want to share with you guys.
Butterfly in the sky, I can go twice as high. Take a look, it's in a book, a reading rainbow. I can go anywhere, friends to know and ways to grow, a reading rainbow. I can be anything. it's in a book, a reading rainbow,
Yeah, man. Shafiq says this is a really good chapter that connects with the Benin bronze depictions of Africans and Europeans trading iron manilas that were used as money and for smelting. So, you know, Shafiq, you must have went ahead and read this chapter. So that's good, man. It's a very good book, very informative book. It destroys the two extremes. So you see a lot of extremes. I was watching Chrissy Harris versus Yara, and the two extremes, the Afrocentrics will say there are no Jews in West Africa. And then, they'll say they're all converts. That's the extreme argument on their side. And then you will have the extreme argument from the BHI that will say that none of them were converts. And here's the thing. This book puts everything in perspective. There were Sephardic Jews coming into West Africa, converting African people, but also having children and leaving their offspring on the coast of Africa. So the Afrocentrics leave that part out because they don't want to accept Jews, right? It's all about an anti-Jew movement, anti-Semitic movement with Afrocentrics. They've always been anti-Semitic. That's where the BHIs get it from. They all come from the same root. And again, BHIs will say there are no converts, and that's a lie. There were people converted into Judaism in the 16th and 15th centuries, and also the 17th centuries. They were converted into European Judaism, like I said, via if they were house servants or just cultural exchange. As we've read thus far, you had cultural exchange between the Portuguese Jews and the locals of the coast of Guinea region, the Gambia region, the Senegalese region, the Senegambia region, all these places you had people having cultural exchange and even finding common ground with African rituals like circumcision. So they're not telling the entire story. And the reason why they don't have the knowledge to tell the entire story, because no one sat down and said, listen, I'm going to read these books cover to cover to actually grasp this. And this is why I love repeating the biblical principle, understand what thou readest and all thy getting. Get if understanding. So we want to understand this topic here of the forgotten diaspora and the Jewish communities in West Africa. Right? So let's go. Let's get this thing started, man. Of course, Afrocentrists, they hate anything outside of making us just Stone Age Africans and anything else. But, what hurts them the most is the DNA data, which we've been doing a great job of presenting the information and formulating our arguments and extrapolating our arguments. Again, we have a theory is an interpretation of facts. So we interpret the facts to the best of our ability. And at the end of the day, the Wolofs having that Eurasian connection, the Fula having that Eurasian connection dating to about 3,000 years ago makes it possible.
It's possible.
Yes, right, Shafiq. It definitely demonstrated that there were black and white Jews, conversos, and everything in between. It is indeed possible. Yap is within the Jewish gene pool, whether it be E1B1B, E1B1A, or E1A, or EM33, or whatnot. Our ancestors are definitely present in that, and they've been there for 3,000 plus years. And that just cannot be denied. And again, having that migration from that region coming to Africa is very much so possible.
It's possible. It's possible. It's possible. It's possible. It's possible.
All right. So with that being said, shalom, my brother Rue. Let's get it right. Let's get right into the body bag. So we're in the blade weapons trade chapter. last chapter was dealing with the religious interactions between basically Jews, Muslims, and Christians, and also the African locals and their traditions. And as we brought out the African tradition, they found some common ground there, and they even started to practice African rituals and traditions. And wait till we get to the portion where it talks about the origins of the weapons trade to West Africa. It's going to make a lot of you Afrocentrists that tried to romanticize our history and act as if we never did anything wrong or anything egregious in your eyes and your view. It's going to make you upset because, oh, history's not like that. History is filled with good and bad. It's not just one angle or one viewpoint. It's what you would consider good and bad. And our people played a pivotal role in all of those things, whether good or bad, as we can see with the slave trade, right? Like we learned the last two chapters that there was an African king that played a major, like sold the most Africans in the region. Like he had that title. So it's like, you can't just ignore things like that because you want to make West Africa seem to be very utopic, and it's they're humans. These are humans we're dealing with. Anywho, so let's get into the fourth chapter, the blade weapons trade in 17th century West Africa. We're 120 pages in. We will finish this book. All right, so with that being stated, I don't know how y'all let me beat y'all when it comes to, you know, reading and stuff of that. You guys, I work a lot of hours and I'm still able to read more than you guys. That's a problem. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, big stream. Let's get it in. The blade weapons trade in 7th century West Africa. And also, for anybody wondering, we are covered under the Copyright Act, Section 107 of the Copyright Act. If anybody's wondering, we are covered. Section 107 of the Copyright Act provides the statutory framework for determining whether something is fair use and identifies certain types of uses such as criticism, commentary, teaching, scholarship, and research. So I will be using this material as teaching and scholarship and research. I will be giving my commentary here, critiques here and there. So we are well within our right to share this information under the fair use under the Section 107 of the Copyright Act. That being stated, let's get back. Let's get back to it, man. So, chapter 4, it states the blade weapons trade in 17th century West Africa. Recently discovered archival sources of the Lisbon Inquisition document the production of blade weapons or armas brancas by Lisbon-based artisans. Working with traders who contracted for the swords, many of these contractors were New Christians. And remember, the New Christians is the name for Jews because they converted into Christianity. It says, during a 30-year period from 1590 to 1618, the weapons were transported to the rivers of Guinea, where they were traded to African elites. After 1608, the Jewish merchants who had settled on the Petite Côte became important players in this coastal commerce. In West Africa, the weapons were exchanged for slaves and other goods. This commerce in swords and daggers contravened a papal bull that prohibited Christians from trading weapons to non-Christians. The commerce, largely ignored by historians, is corroborated by Portuguese travel narratives from the period. However, the weapons trade actually had its origins in the mid-15th century with the arrival of the Portuguese on the Atlantic coast of West Africa. Both the production and the military use of armas brancas, the name refers to white tinge of the steel-bladed hand weapons, was highly developed in Portugal. These specialized arms came in many different forms. Espadas were double-edged, full-length swords that were wielded in the right hand. The more readily handled tercados mentioned earlier were ideal for cavalry use. Short arms took the form of adagas, with a broad, short, and pointed blade, generally with two cutting edges and punhais, with narrower and smaller blades. The adaga, corresponding more closely to the English dagger, was wielded in the left hand. European fighting men generally carried such a weapon in their left hand, while their right hand held an espada. who tended to carry a shield in the left hand. While use of the tactic made Portuguese infantrymen slightly more vulnerable to slashing wounds, it gave them a significant advantage in agility during hand-to-hand combat. Hilts of both swords and daggers were protected by a metal guard. The guards became increasingly complex and embellished in the course of the 16th and 17th centuries. These specialized weapons and the associated tactical expertise made the Portuguese greatly feared soldiers in the 16th century. Their armas brancas were superior to early firearms, particularly in close combat situations. They represented the latest developments in weapons technology for the century and a half during which Portugal dominated the Guinea trade. It is no surprise that by the late 16th century, swords and short swords were in demand as trade items throughout Senegambia. Inquisition sources indicate that as many as 10 traders in Lisbon knew Christians for the most part, and 7 subcontractors were actively assembling swords during an 8 or 9 year period leading up to 1618. Several of the men produced 50 or 60 weapons per year, and one trader had ordered 200 swords for assembly and shipping at the same time. It is difficult to calculate the total number of swords produced because some of the contractors were only involved in production for a few years. And because the number of weapons for which each was responsible ranged from 18 to as many as 60 per year, 5 or 6 artisans appear to have been involved on a continuing basis, and at least 2 men, Antonio Fernandez and Manuel Teixeira, had been making weapons for 30 years. Belchor Espinosa also began producing in 1590, although he had stopped before 1618. Thus, a minimum of 300 swords were produced annually, but with an upper limit that may be estimated at 500 to 600 weapons. Over the period of 8 or 9 years documented by the Inquisition report of 1618, this trade would have amounted to a total between 3,200 and 5,000 weapons. The figures for the 1590s may have been slightly higher, as the Inquisition documents list 8 artisans for that period. Only the assembly and decoration of the swords and scabbards took place in Lisbon. Their espadilleros or barbereros de espadas assembled the finished weapons from blades that they imported from Italy from the Flanders. In 1590, Italians were also mentioned in one of the Portuguese traders later obtained blades from Felipe Giacome Mercador Flamengo. The works of finishing consisting of finishing a hilt, sometimes out of precious metal. In Lisbon, the blade, hilt, and scabbard were decorated, often by subcontractors working in their own homes. The hilts were varied. Some were made of tin from Flanders, others of iron from Porto, while yet others were colored metal wire. One type of sword, the tocado, was about 3.5 or 4 palms in length. As a palmo measured 22 centimeters, the tocados were 77 to 88 centimeters long. Some were curved and others had straight blades. A few of the tocados had white hilts and red scabbards. A small number were made with gilt belts. These were destined for African nobility. The term tocado is still used today in Guinea-Bissau. A mid-19th century watercolor by the French military officer and explorer Hicard depicts a pure horseman wearing one of these weapons at his waist. The trade in the blade weapons from Lisbon to Upper Guinea Coast developed before 1590, and it expanded over subsequent decades in response to a complex international web of commercial, military, and diplomatic factors that reached from Lisbon to Amsterdam, but that also incorporated Morocco and the Sahel region of West Africa. Shout out to the Fulani. Before 1590, when it came to the attention of Inquisition informants, the blade weapons trade received a boost due to events in Morocco. The development of a modern armaments industry under Ahmed al-Mansur during the 1580s, followed in 1591 by Mansur's invasion and conquest of the Songhai Empire, brought thousands of armas brancas across the Sahara, disrupted the military balance of power there, and led to the burgeoning African demand for weapons from the inland delta of the Niger River to the Atlantic coast. In fact, the alfange, a large curved sword used by the Moroccan armies, was also produced in Lisbon by 1590 and sold on the coast of northern Senegambia, as narrative sources confirm. The subsequent entry of the Sephardic merchants into the West African sword trade was likely a result of the establishment of diplomatic military, and commercial contacts between Morocco and the Netherlands. The arrival in Amsterdam of the Moroccan mission under Samuel Palach brought up-to-date information about the West African demand for blade weapons. Furthermore, commercial networks based in Amsterdam could ignore the papal bull. Central to these networks were Jewish merchant families with commercial ties in Lisbon, Amsterdam, Fez, Marrakesh, and Senegal. As we mentioned in the prior chapters, the prior reading of the chapters, it's pretty much clear that, you know, these Jews being expelled to these different places, Lisbon, Amsterdam, to Fez, Marrakesh, and Senegal, and made them have access to powerful trade networks because they have familial ties in these different areas. So it's no wonder that they were able to succeed in that. And also, these weapons are coming down because the Songhai Empire and other African tribes are like, listen, we about to fight these guys. So they go to Portugal and they buy their swords and weapons as well. Right here, and they show that famous watercolor picture that they were talking about, a fool, I believe, on horseback. Anyway, the origins of the weapons trade to West Africa. In 1488, Bumi Jelin, Wolof claimant to the throne of Wolof, the most powerful state in northern Senegal, traveled to Lisbon to seek Portuguese support for his claim. While in Portugal, he converted to Christianity, and when he sailed back to Senegal on a Portuguese caravel, King João provided him with weapons. King João's support was conditioned on Bumi's conversions. Quite likely, this support was also intended as a signal to encourage other African rulers to accept Christianity. So, real quick, a note on that. As you can see, an African ruler actually goes to Portugal to receive weapons, right? So he can claim his throne. Let's keep reading. So almost 30 years earlier, a very different sequence of events had taken place in 1460, just after the death of Henry the Navigator. Alfonso V, King of Portugal, dispatched a caravel to the Petite Cote. He gave the captain Diogo Gomes, who already had experience sailing around the Guinea coast, 10 horses to trade, along with authority over all ships he would find there. Because he knew there were caravels that took swords and weapons to the Moors, giving Gomes orders to bring them under guard to him in Portugal. Gomes was, of course, tracking illegal traders. One of these interpolers was captured, brought to the city of Oporto, and tortured for having brought weapons to the Moors. Fearing a similar fate, Mendo Afonso and early Lancado, who had taken swords to Guinea, remained on the coast living among African Muslims until 1463, when he asked the king for a pardon. The ensuing 150 years witnessed growing commerce between Portugal and West Africa in exchange for ivory, wax, hides, and increasingly by the final decades of the 16th century, slaves. Portuguese merchants brought iron, even though it too was illegal, textiles, and horses to Guinea. By the last two decades of the 16th century, weapons, especially iron swords, were an important component of Portuguese exports to Africa. A close reading of 16th and early 17th century Portuguese narratives indicates that these weapons were highly in demand in the Wolof and Serer states of northern Senegambia, as well as among the Banyuns, Kasangas, and other populations in the Gambia-Bissau region. A papal bull in Coina Domini, promulgated in 1364 and reissued annually until 1774, prohibited, among other offenses, the sale of weapons to the infidel upon pain of excommunication. By the late 1500s, if the Portuguese expressed public scruples about contravening the papal bull, their French, Dutch, and English trading rivals had no such compunctions. Portuguese Lancados, who had settled on the Senegambian coast, played an important role as intermediaries in this international commerce. If one wished to obtain slaves, it was necessary to offer armas brancas. By the early 17th century, Lisbon merchants, too, were deeply involved in the trade. By 1590, the production of armas brancas for the African market had become a specialized industry. Archival records of the Lisbon Inquisition indicate that Portugal was a major source of all manners of swords. In Lisbon, the short swords called espadas cortas or tocados became a crucial part of the slave trade. Production of these weapons, which were ideally suited for cavalry, came to be largely controlled by new Christian contractors. These men were, in fact, the heirs to the long-established Jewish artisan tradition in the production and trade of armas brancas, a profession that was practiced not only in Europe, but also in Morocco. While contemporary narratives and archival documents firmly document a thriving weapons trade between Europe and the Upper Guinea Coast from 1590 to the 1620s, earlier sources offer evidence of a more limited commerce. The conjunction of several historical factors caused the weapons trade to the Sahel and the Upper Guinea Coast to grow significantly at the end of the 16th century. First, as other European nations challenged Portugal's trade monopoly, the ban on selling weapons to non-Christians could not be enforced. Two of the competitors, England and the United Provinces, were not Catholic states. Their merchants ignored the papal ban with impunity, as did French Huguenot privateers, particularly after the Edict of the Nantes in 1598. Second, Portuguese Lucanos and their Luso-African descendants who had settled among African populations on the West African mainland quickly entered into contact with the French, English, Dutch, interpreters, providing them with African trade goods in return for weapons. Many of the Lucanos were Christians. The Dutch merchants, of course, included numerous Jews of Portuguese origin. The two groups, who in some instances were related, quickly entered into a commercial partnership. They certainly were not bothered by the existence of a papal bull prohibiting arms trade to the infidels. As early as 1594, Portuguese authorities in the Cape Verde Islands were aware that new Christian Lucanos were procuring weapons from Protestant merchants. In that year, D. Fray Pedro Brandão, Bishop of Cape Verde, complained about the Lucanos that those of the nation are the lords of commercial entry and of ports. And in these regions, they trade with the Lutherans, for whom they retain merchandise to give them when they come to the coast. And in this manner, the foreigners make great profits while they deliver them to them goods that are prohibited by the bull. The prohibited goods were clearly weapons. So again, what this is telling you is that the Jews played a major role in this trade of weapons throughout Western Africa. These guys were basically dominating this as well. And as we can see that these people, like I said before, played a major role. So let's keep reading here. Third, as the Inquisition reports from 1590 and 1618 indicate, the production of short swords to export to Guinea, Cabo Verde, already significant by the earlier date, developed during those 30 years into an important industry in Lisbon. Fourth, the international weapons trade to West Africa was both affected by and itself influenced contemporary events in Morocco. The Moroccan invasion of Songhai in 1591 was a seminal episode in the military history of the Sahel. The victory of the army of the Saadian ruler Ahmed al-Mansur, the Battle of Tombidi, had a far-reaching impact on the subsequent arms trade from the inland delta of the Niger River to the West African coast. Shortly after he defeated the Portuguese army at Alcazar in 1578, Mansour had begun to develop a modern arms industry based in Marrakesh. The Moroccan invasion of Songhai 13 years later brought great numbers of these weapons into the Sahel and provided graphic evidence of the effectiveness of both armas brancas and mobile artillery. By the end of Mansour's reign in 1603, he had also begun to establish diplomatic and commercial ties to the United Provinces. These ties, which expanded under his successor, were mediated by Jewish merchants of Portuguese descent. Ultimately, the court of Marrakesh, assisted by more Moroccan Jews, but at the same time facing competition from Jewish traders based in Holland, played a central role in the establishment of a complex network of military and commercial connections that linked Morocco to Northern Europe trade networks and that connected both Marrakesh and Amsterdam to weapon trades in West Africa. The historical sources in 1590, Manuel de Entrada Castelo Branco wrote a long tract about warfare and trade in the Atlantic for Philip II of Spain. Philip I of Portugal. Coincidentally, this text, written in Spanish, provides an early detailed account of the French commercial presence on Senegal's Petit Côte. Castelo Branco writes, in Besiguiche, capital of the kingdom of Halafo, there is large, capacious, and beautiful bay where 100 deep drafted vessels may anchor. And here in this port in Escali arrive Lutherans from La Rochelle, Bordeaux, and Havre de Grace, and from Brittany, along with other pirates. And their navigation unimpeded brings to France much gold, amber, ivory, hides, various valuable civet, all in great quantity, leaving behind an abundance of instruments of war for the Wolofs, who are in the process of accepting the sect of Muhammad, including lances, creces, espadas, alfanges, shields, and other objects that are prohibited by the Bull of Sina. The French, English, and other pirates, as Castelo Branco indicates, were actively involved in trade along the Petit Côte, and the Portuguese were not able to impede them. Castelo Branco is explicit. They traded weapons to the Wolofs, who were Muslims. At least their rulers and nobility were Muslims. The author describes in detail the weapons that are traded. It is highly significant that this report cites espadas and alfanges, the two weapons cited by a precisely contemporary Inquisition report as being traded from Lisbon to Guinea. We do not know whether an internal Holy Office report was one of Castelo Branco's sources. It is, however, certainly significant that espadas and alfanges are also documented in 16th century ivory carvings from Sierra Leone. It is not clear whether tacados, the short swords that were ideally suited for cavalry, are included among the weapons described by Castelo Branco. Two decades later, tacados had become the backbone of the weapons trade to Senegambia. In his commentary on this passage, Paul Hare cast doubt on Castelo Branco's assertion that the French and English were selling weapons to the Wolofs. Hare's refutation is surprising, given that Castelo Branco includes a detailed list of different types of weapons allegedly traded. Hare writes, although the French and British of this period paid for the products they brought from Africans and from Amerindians by selling European manufacturers, and although these frequently included iron tools and metal containers, it's unlikely that in either Africa or America, large quantities of weapons were handed over. Hare was a meticulous scholar, and he was intimately familiar with historical research for all of Guinea do Cabo Verde. In his commentary, he directly contests Andrada's claim that French traded large quantities of armas blancas to the Wolofs. That such a careful scholar could have contested Andrada's account reflects the fact that, at least as of 1990, this early sword and dagger trade was totally unknown to Western historians of Africa. In 1970, Walter Rodney, in his pioneer work, A History of the Upper Guinea Coast, noted the existence of an important illegal trade in weapons, including swords. But the earliest source he cites for the sale of these weapons by Portuguese and Afro-Portuguese is from the second half of the 17th century. In the account of Limos Coelho, while he linked this business to Lencados and their descendants, he undervalued the role of African markets in the demand for swords. In his classic work, Economic Change in Pre-Colonial Africa, Senegambia in the Area, in the Era of the Slave Trade, published in 1975, Philip Curtin lists swords and cutlasses among the Senegambian imports from 1680s to the 1730s. Curtin did not pay specific attention to this trade, nor did he provide information on its historical origins. Nevertheless, he mentions Flemish knives and back from Solingen, a renowned German center for sword production, as an example of items that had been in demand from the early days of trade with Europe, simply because people were used to certain products the Dutch or the Portuguese had first supplied. But referring to the Senegambian trade in the 16th and 17th century, he omits again the role that the sword and cutlass trade may have played, although he does mention the Portuguese horse trade on this point, but only for the late 17th century. Rodney goes further than Curtin. He quotes the English chief factor in the Gambia, who stated in 1683 that trade southward to Cachao was impossible without iron and good swords. Similar statements are found in the Inquisition sources some 70 years before. in his seminal 1999 study, Warfare in Atlantic Africa, 1500 to 1800, John Thornton studies the weaponry used by cavalry and infantry in Senegambia and in a wider region of Upper Guinea. Based on his readings of contemporary 16th and 17th century sources, Thornton observes that African cavalry found firearms to be less useful than swords or spears. Yet in his entire monograph, Thornton has only a single reference to daggers, and that is from 1788 for Dahomey. The Portuguese weapons trade in armas brancas to Senegambia is not cited. This oversight by another highly respected historian is hardly surprising. Many 16th century chroniclers did not directly mention the commerce, which was largely surreptitious, reflecting the illegal nature of the weapons trade of the non-Christians. Castelo Branco's 1590s account is not, however, the only late 16th century reference to the blade weapons trade. The evidence clearly shows that this commerce was thriving by the 1590s. The first Inquisition report from November 1590 confirms the growth of this clandestine activity and the significant numbers of weapons exported. According to the Inquisition informant, 9 different artisans were employed assembling swords, 8 of them for the rivers of Guinea, 1 for Angola. The 1590s Inquisition report offers some details about the trade. A specific kind of sword known as an alfanje, a kind of large curved saber with yellow leather sheath, was in particular demand. This weapon was being subcontracted to almost all the artisans by merchants connected to the Guinea trade. Some information is also specified about the African clients for these swords. The weapons were sent to Guinea, where Moors trade with blacks who live in that coast. The biggest concern of the Inquisition was that the weapons might not come into the possession of Muslims. That this indeed occurred in the confirmation in the 1618 report, where a witness reports they sent a great quantity of these espadas to the rivers of Guinea, to gentios who live adjacent to the Moors and who trade the said espadas with them. Who were these Moors? In Portuguese sources of that time, the category Moor could have 2 different meanings, a general one as a synonym for Muslims wherever they were, or a specific meaning, the nomadic inhabitants of Mauritania. If we follow the first meaning, which seems correct for the 1618 account, the documents would simply be saying that black non-Muslim traders were purchasing the swords, which then were resold to Muslims. For instance, the Muslim trading partners, as we know, consisted both of members of the Wolof political elite and of Muslim agents of the Mande trade network that connected the Guinea coast to the inland Sahel. But in the 1590s quotation, we believe the second meaning was being used. By 1590, as we know from Castelo Branco's account, blade weapons, including alfanje and daggers, were arriving on the coast of Holofo. Andre Alvarez de Almada's treatise, manuscript of circa 1596, reads that blacks were learning cavalry techniques from the Moors who came from the desert. They learned these tricks from the Moors who normally follow the Wolof court and who come there to sell horses. The same traders who sold horses would likely have sold cavalry weapons. In the 1590 Inquisition report, the Negroes who sold these weapons were likely Wolofs, and the Moors who brought them were likely the Saharan caravan. Merchants who had business with the Wolof royal courts exchanging horses for other merchandise. In his slightly earlier account of circa 1592 and 1593, Andre Alvarez de Almeida reports that the cavalry of Cayor were equipped with a short sword up to 3.5 palms long, the plain handle without hand guards. They wore these swords crosswise, and they used knives instead of daggers of a palm and a palm and a half long. The short swords or espadas appear to have been synonymous with the tocados. The short swords of Cayor without guards on the hilt were not finished by the Portuguese standards. In fact, the Portuguese did export unfinished espada blades to be finished by African artisans. These smiths were probably mending. The weapons were fashioned in the Portuguese style, hence there clearly existed a local Senegambian industry for swords, daggers, and shields that followed a Portuguese model. This was part of a wider iron industry that also included ironwork for Portuguese ships. The technological complementary was facilitated by the Portuguese language skills of demanding craftsmen. Donhelha, for example, had a client whose blacksmiths were working to satisfy his order who spoke Portuguese. This was certainly relevant when Portuguese and Tagalogs needed to order specific and detailed work such as sword handles. At the very end of the century, the account of João Barbosa confirms a strong French, English, and Dutch commercial presence in the region of the Senegal River. This trade has been established many years ago, a fact confirmed by the use of French as lingua franca in the region. Barbosa adds that the Tagalogs traded iron, presumably obtained from the aforementioned European merchants, to the blacks who then used it to make weapons. It is also possible that the Wolofs, who in the 1590s were making at least some of their own weapons, imported iron. The Wolofs did not themselves produce the metal in quantity. In consequence, some of their weapons were probably fashioned in the Gambia, where Monday blacksmith experts in forging iron could readily be found. André Donnelha, writing in the 1625, but referring to his travels in the Gambia during the 1580s, writes that in the trading town of Kasile, the Lakatos or Tagalogs ordered swords and daggers and even shields from local blacksmiths. Here at Kasan, excellent round shields are made, and if we order them, they are made in our style. They are covered with leather and painted, and the Tagalogs have sheaths made for the swords and daggers and have them decorated since there are good craftsmen here. Again, if anybody doesn't know what a Tagalog is, it's basically the same thing as a new Christian. As someone that's our Lankado outcast, someone that's coming from Portugal and is outcast from Portugal, or just Portugal descent. Most likely, these people were Jewish and African descendants, mixed Jewish and African ancestry as well. So again, Jews playing a role in the weapons trade as well. The sheaths that the Tagalogs ordered were produced in Lisbon, according to the 1590 Inquisition report. These sheaths, too, are made of painted leather. Some say that the sword makers, have finished these espadas and alfanjes in yellow leather for Guinea for the person who ordered these espadas. Iron was a central trading item throughout the region, and it was crucial for making not only weapons, but also agricultural tools. Almada, too, comments on the production of iron weapons by the mining blacksmiths. He writes that the Manding of the Gambia are very warlike, and this land has more weapons than any other of Guinea, because as it has iron which they forge, they make many arms in the form of spears, dardos, stabbing daggers, and arrows. Late 16th century iron production in Senegal involved Manding smiths who were closely linked to the importation both of finished iron weapons and of unfinished blades from Europe. These local smiths also turned out weapons to European specifications. Almeida makes interesting reference to Manding merchants who carry short swords, like other Africans who also wore two fakas, which is knives, one on the belt and other on the left arm. On their heads, they wear red berets that they call turquinas, which they apparently obtained from the Turks. Who one would like to know were these Turks? Turquina is apparently a Portuguese term, but in philological dictionaries, it is never translated as cap or hat. This could imply that the term, if not the headdress itself, had come to the Manding traders via Portuguese intermediaries. However, it is also possible that this term, like other loan words, was an adaptation to Portuguese of a local word and used by the Mande traders, a word with a foreign origin, like the word for all imported objects. But is not an alternative physical route, namely the trans-Saharan trade, also possible? A red and yellow hat was used by the Turkish armies in Morocco at the time of Kibir. In view of the Turkish influence on the Moroccan armies, there may be a connection between the appearance in Senegambia of the caps and the daggers, and association of the items with the North African merchants who plied the trans-Saharan trade route. We have indirect confirmation that the specific kind of cap was in demand in the Sahel and was brought by that trade. Colored caps or bonnets, in the words of an anonymous Spanish writer, were among the goods selected by Wadar al-Mansar's general to placate the blacks his army encountered as he approached the Niger to conquer the city of Gayo. Therefore, the terminology does reflect the 16th century trade in the blade weapons from Morocco to Timbuktu with the swords then shipped west along the Mande trading network. In fact, physical evidence exists that cavalrymen in the region of the inland delta of the Niger River wore knives on their left arms. Several of the terracotta figures and style associated with Jenny Genoa dating from the 13th to 16th century portray cavalrymen armed with daggers. Several pieces of doggone sculpture, including a cavalryman on horseback and the Robert and Adrian McNutchin collection, depict a warrior with a curved dagger fitted neatly into a holster on his upper left arm, where this figure life-sized the weapon would be about 1 or 1.5 pommels long. This is precisely the kind of weapon that is described by Almada. Furthermore, the point of the origin of this sculpture in Dogon country along the Bundigaga escarpment in Mali is very close to both the southern terminus of the caravan route to Morocco and the point of impact of the Moroccan invasion of 1591. This Dogon piece is dated 1650 to 1800. If the early range for the date 1650 is accurate, then we have nearly contemporary evidence of the weapons described by Almada. The dagger would either have been acquired through the trans-Saharan weapons trade or made by local blacksmiths based upon North African prototypes. In Senegambia, the Inquisition report of 1590 and the accounts of Almada, Barbosa, and Castelo Branco demonstrates that significant numbers of espadas were imported from Europe during the last two decades of the 16th century. In northern Senegal, many weapons used in Kayor continue to be of local manufacture. Sources from the mid-15th and early 16th century report the use of short swords and daggers in the region. These weapons were found south as far as Rio Grande, southern Guinea-Bissau, and even in Sierra Leone. Some were the product of local technology, but increasing numbers were imported from Europe. From their earliest commercial contact with Senegambians, the Portuguese tried to respond to local demand by bringing the kind of weapon that were also arriving by the caravan trade. In Greater Senegambia, where the Wolofs used both imported weapons and arms of local manufacture, demand for European-made swords and daggers was widespread. It was not limited to cavalry. According to Almada, Wolof foot soldiers were armed with the same weapons as their cavalry. Their foot soldiers used the same arms as their cavalry. Neighboring states, too, sought to equip their fighting forces with these weapons. They would have had to do so in order to maintain a semblance of military and political balance of power and to protect their independence. Along the Petit Côte, as Dunhill reports, the Bersin could not rely on cavalry because his territory was densely wooded. Nevertheless, in addition to 2,000 archers, this ruler could also put 300 horsemen onto the list. Parenthetically, Dunhill Ha's passage illustrates the desiccation that this part of the Senegal has undergone in four centuries. Today, the land is largely open, and horsemen would have no trouble moving through the widely spread trees that flourish there. South of the Gambia River, too, in the Casamance and in northern Guinea-Bissau, where the more heavily forested land rendered cavalry ineffective. Soldiers were armed with iron weapons and were possible with espadas. Almada writes of the Kasangas of the Casamance, who were redoubtable warriors. In warfare, they used spears, arrows, shields, knives, short swords like the Wolof, and the same clothing. The Boramo people of Cachao carry similar weapons. In Sierra Leone, the southeastern limit of Guinea of Cape Verde, the presence of armas brancas is seen in Almada's description of the Manes, who had supposedly invaded the coastal Sapis people in about 1550. These Manes, Almada writes, carried a short sword and instead of a shield, a knife attached to their left upper arm. Sierra Leone is also the subject of Dunhill Ha's description. Among the Susus, iron is smelted in a large quantity from which they make swords, spears, knives, and iron tools to work the fields, and they bring them to sell in Sierra Leone. Perhaps the most detailed description of blade weapons is a source dating from the second half of the 17th century. In 1669, the French traveler Nicolas writes of this region. Their arms consist of sabers, daggers, spears, bowls, and arrows. Sabers and poniards may be translated respectively as swords and daggers. It is unclear, however, whether these weapons were of European or local African manufacture. All right. The organization of commerce on the West African coast. Jewish merchants in Senegambia traded for ivory, hide, and wax. Trade generally took place through intermediaries. These intermediaries consisted of Portuguese Lancados, many of whom were New Christian and Euro-African Portuguese, referred to as Filhos da Terra. The Lancados began to trade with the Portuguese Jews as soon as the latter settled in Senegal, a fact that strongly suggests pre-existing contact. So that's telling right there. Go ahead and give us a good highlight right there. So that basically is saying that maybe there was a pre-existing contact between the Lancados and the Portuguese Jews at that time. They knew of each other, right? Eventually, some of these Jews themselves became Lancados, staying on the coast to organize local trades. Who was receiving and reselling the swords on the coast between 1590 and 1618? The answer is clear in Almada's treatise. It was the Lancados who dealt in forbidden merchandise. At the end of Almada's 1592 and 1593 manuscript, there are unpublished editions indicating that increasing numbers of Lancados were New Christian and Jews, and that these merchants regularly avoided bringing their goods through or paying duties at Santiago Island. Almada writes, and there's another reason, which is that there are traveling on these ships many members of the nation, as well as foreigners, who, as they do not pay duty to return and finding the land good to live in and to benefit from what they want, and not having to face justice there, they throw in their lot with the pagans, and they offer no more than to give their acquisitions to our French and English enemies. In this matter of giving their goods to them, even the factors of the contractors in these parts are inhabited by doing this, by their partners with whom they have companies, and we can hardly avoid this situation if we don't close the ports again. Subsequent documents from the Lisbon documents from the Lisbon Inquisition show that part of this trade was in prohibited merchandise. This includes reports of Father de Geronimo da Cunha, former vicar of Cachao. Of all the places where there are enemies, none is more prejudicial to our religion than this coast, where not only are there publicly declared Jews, but furthermore, it is a trading center for all the sea pirates, and where they go to sell all their booty and contraband, and where they deliver iron and arms to the blacks and other prejudicial items that are prohibited by the Bull of Seville. Of course, the public Jews of Petitcoat became part of this network soon after their arrival. Confirmation of their involvement as intermediaries in the trade comes from the Cunha's successor, Bartolomeo. I even don't mention the fact that on the coast, they trade with the Lutherans and the pirates, purchasing items that are contrary to the bull of the Lord. Information about the Senegambian weapon dealers is also found among the documents from the Lisbon Inquisition. This is hardly surprising, given the existence of the papal bull that banned trading of weapons to Muslims. It says, and these merchants, all of whom are new Christians, send a great quality of espadas to the rivers of Guinea, whose populations are gentios and border on the lands of the Muslims. The espadas, short swords described in the documents, are tercados. These tercados constituted a crucial trade item for the slave trade. One witness, Domingos Fernandez himself, a Lisbon-based weapons subcontractor, told the Inquisition that the short swords were sent to Cachao, where they served along with other goods to obtain slaves. Another of Lisbon's base sword traders, an old Christian, was said to have a list of clients for the swords on the Guinea coast. This man, Diogo, had served as a secretary to the former governor of Angola, João, Araujo's earlier posting is significant for, as John Thornton tells us, swords were used by Luso African armies in the Angolan Wars. It is probable that this old Christian was familiar with sword production in Lisbon and used his knowledge to set up a new illegal business. At least five of the other traders were new Christians. One of them was Fernando Ribeiro, who's mostly probably was the son-in-law of Luis Gramacho, a member of one of the main families of slave traders at that time. He lived in the home of his father-in-law in Lisbon and had been in St. Domingos and in Cartagena de las Indias in South America early in 1606. Another merchant is identified as a black man. Was he one of the Euro-African Jews of the Petit Coat? So again, this book is just recapitulating that these Luso Africans, these new Christians, did play a role with the slave trade, all right? Let's keep going. In 1612, both João López de Costa and Antonio Nunes arrived on the coast. There they engaged in business transactions with another slave trader from Cartagena named Manuel Bautista Perez. Perez was a nephew of Diogo Rodriguez, one of the sword traders cited in the Inquisition source of 1618. A second, Antonio Nunes, also shows up in the documents. He was again on the coast trading swords in 1618. Until 1614, João Sarero was, of course, the link between these new Christians and Jews on the coast. Manuel Pinto de Oliveira, Antonio João da Costa all came to the Guinea coast as partners of the contractor. Trade documents recently discovered in the National Archives in Lima, Peru, by Linda Newsom, provides a detailed account of a series of commercial transactions. They describe the contents and disposition of two boatloads of trade goods that arrived in Cachao in 1660. The ship sailed from Lisbon. One of the owners was the same Diogo, who appears 2 years later on the Inquisition list of sword dealers. One vessel carried two boxes containing a total of 148 swords. Further, a large case from India contained 11 gilt swords, three of which also had tassels. In addition, there were two silver trocados. These India swords sold for much higher price than those made in Lisbon. In Guinea, the most elaborately decorated swords decorated with velvet scabbards and golden tassels served as prestige items. This is not surprising if you remember that as early as 1590, Andrada de Castell Branco mentions the creces, the Malayan daggers, were being sold in northern Senegambia. Nevertheless, it is astounding to realize that swords were produced on two different continents for export to a third continent. It is interesting to compare the quality of swords exported from Lisbon, 400 to 600 per year, with the total number of horsemen in Senegambia, a figure that historian John Thornton estimates at 15,000. Imported horses, as historian James Webb has noted, were exchanged for slaves, and the link between imported horses and exported slaves was direct. The horse and slave trade was fundamental to the success of the small cavalry states of the savannah. The horse trade, one might add, was also closely connected with the sale of armas broncas. So if anybody's not keeping up thus far, again, what they're saying here is the local Africans would trade their slaves, right? They would trade slaves to get horses, swords, and stuff of that nature. So, again, so for all the people that try to romanticize West Africa and saying that they did nothing wrong, they were just victims, they played a part in the slave trade as well. So I keep, this, you know, this theme is going to keep coming up throughout this book. All right, anyway, given the present state of our knowledge, we do not know all the sources of imported blade weapons. Nevertheless, given the level of production estimated in the Inquisition documents, it could well have taken a generation to equip all the West African cavalry with trocados. Clearly, demand for these specialized weapons were exceeded by the supply. European supply would have played a critical role in the time of war by complementing the weapons produced by local African blacksmiths. Through 19th century, Indonesia, Malaysia steel. Oh, this is talking about this figure right here. This is a dagger right here. It's talking about the Indonesia, the Malaysian daggers that some of these Africans were getting their hands on. It says here, while the origins within Portugal of the specialized weapons production for the Senegambian trade remain obscure, a new Christian role early in the 16th century is probable. Since at least the end of the 15th century, much of the weapon production in Morocco and in Northern Sahara was in the hands of Sephardic Jewish artisans. All right. In the Moroccan city of Fez, where the Jewish population dated to the foundation of the city, Jews inhabited their own quarter, the Mala, from the early 15th century. They, together with the fugitives from the Spanish expulsion of 1492, from the Portuguese forced conversion of 1496 to 1497, were protected by the Sultan of Fez. After the Inquisition was established in Portugal, some Portuguese new Christians immigrated to Fez in order to live publicly as Jews. Through the resulting family ties and diplomatic connections, commercial information was rapidly exchanged between merchants in Morocco and Portugal. Following the Portuguese military disaster at Alcázar, Quibir, in 1578, numerous Portuguese captives, including some old Christians, chose to live among Jews of Mela. Since many of the latter spoke Castilian or Portuguese, Jewish merchants, the descendants of Esposos, maintained regular contact between Fez and Lisbon through the 16th century. Some of them traveled back and forth as diplomats in the service of the Sultan. In Morocco, Jewish artisans were especially valued for their work with iron and steel weapons and with the manufacture of artillery. Several 16th century Jewish artisans came to the attention of the Inquisition for having provided weapons to the Muslim rulers of Fez. Jose Alberto Tavim cites the mid-16th century commentator Bernardo Rodriguez, who rails against weapons manufacturers and munitions producers. These men, he charges, armed the Turks and the Moors, and some of them have been producing swords for the rulers of the Fez for 30 years. Other Jewish merchants were suspected by the Inquisition of importing weapons from Portugal to Morocco. Furthermore, during the reign of Ahmed al-Mansur, the Dutch actively provided a wide range of weapons to Marrakesh. The eyewitness account of Antonio is explicit on this point. The Dutch, who are less scrupulous, provide him with arms of every sort, lances, irons, espadas, guns, powder, and every variety of munitions. In this activity, they joined the English, who, according to Jacques, controlled much of the commerce in the third quarter of the 16th century. With the rise of the Sasanian dynasty during the 16th century, many Moroccan Jewish merchants and artisans turned their allegiance from the Sultan of Fez to Marrakesh. After 1591, al-Mansur's commercial empire extended across the Sahara, but his diplomatic efforts also reached the northern Europe. Toward the end of his reign, he sought an alliance with the government of the Low Countries. Over the next three decades, al-Mansur's successors maintained ongoing diplomatic relations with Amsterdam. They repeatedly tried to obtain weapons and even naval vessels from the Dutch. Members of the Portuguese Jewish community in diaspora, some of whom lived in Morocco and others in Amsterdam, provided the necessary diplomatic and commercial contacts for these projects. Indeed, they were almost certainly involved in the arms trade mentioned by Saldanha. Both Mansur and his successor, Moulay Zaidan, sent the Jewish merchant Samuel on a series of missions to Amsterdam beginning in 1603. Palachi lived in Amsterdam almost continuously for the rest of his life. There, he became an active member of the first Portuguese Jewish synagogue, the Nevi Shalom. It is likely that he knew Jacob Pellegrino personally. Samuel Palachi's arrival, together with his brother Joseph in Amsterdam, would have corresponded with Pellegrino's preparations to depart for Senegambia. Previously, Pellegrino had lived in northern Italy, perhaps in Venice. By 1590, northern Italy was another source of short swords. With his contacts in both Italy and Lisbon, Pellegrino certainly was aware of the weapons trade of Guinea. It is probably that Palachi served as a conduit between his co-religionists in Marrakesh and Amsterdam, enabling them to share the most up-to-date information about the growing demand for weapons, especially armas brancas in the Sahel. New Christian merchants living in Lisbon were not isolated from members of the Portuguese community living outside of Iberia. In addition to contact with the Jewish community in Fez mentioned previously, they were able to maintain communications via Hamburg and Antwerp with their family members in Amsterdam. Shout out to the Netherlands. They won today. If you guys keeping up with the World Cup, I believe they beat Argentina. Anyway, back to the book. From Senegal's petite cote, Jews could travel to Portuguese settlements in the rivers of Guinea and even to Angola. From there, information could be sent directly to their Christian relatives in Lisbon. The resulting international web of information and commerce brought blade weapons to West Africa, both across the Sahara from Morocco and by sea from Portugal, Italy, and from Northern Europe. The important role of Jewish diplomats and traders from Morocco sharing information from North Africa with Northern Europe is articulated by Garcia, Arenal, and Wagers in their study of Samuel Palachi. Jews played important roles in both Moroccan diplomacy and Moroccan trade. Their contacts with fellow Jews in the Iberian Peninsula, the Netherlands, or the Ottoman Empire gained them access to trade networks that were closed to other Moroccans. They also purchased weapons from Northern European Protestant nations, which were unaffected by the papal ban on the sale of arms to Muslim countries. And their familiarity with the arms trade made them especially valuable to Moroccan governments. While merchants like the Palachis helped a succession of sultans in Morocco to obtain weapons from the Dutch, they also brought the knowledge of Moroccan trade networks to Northern Europe. It is clear that while these merchants helped provide arms and information to Morocco, they were also in a position to share knowledge about weapons trade from Marrakesh south across the Sahara with their relatives in Amsterdam and Lisbon. The African destination of weapons. In Kachao, in the rivers of Guinea, as in Senegal, the swords were in great demand. Who were the African recipients of the swords? Once the weapons arrived in the Guinea coast, the Lisbon informant cited in 1618, Inquisition records did not know in whose hands the weapons landed. They could only report that these exporters go through the rivers of Cachao so that with them and other commercial goods, they can trade for blacks. And if they do not bring them, the exporters there will be no trade, and that they trade them to black Christians who take them to the interior of the land and they give them to pagan blacks. The identification of black Christians suggests that these African slave traders may have been the men associated with the King of Busis. Remember, we read last chapter that the King of Busis in this region pretty much was like, he had the highest slave count. He sold the most slaves. He was known for that. In January 1606, the Dutch merchant Peter van den Broek visited Porto Real. He wrote in his journal that he paid customs to the local factor in the form of goods that included iron and 9 rapiers. The next month in Joal, the Dutch factor paid customs to the local ruler in the form of 10 rapiers so that his expedition might trade on shore. The two passages from van den Broek identify clients for the swords. In this instance, the weapons clearly went to members of the local elite. In these situations, the swords were a first tribute to the port dignitaries necessary to open trade. It is possible that a similar role was played in Cachao and São Domingos river trade by special swords destined to the local rulers. In 1610, the Vicar of Cachao wrote to the Inquisition in Lisbon to complain that the Jews of the Petite Cote were trading with the Lutherans, i.e. the Dutch, from whom they purchased things that contravened the papal bull, or in other words, weapons. This was precisely the moment when members of the Portuguese community in Amsterdam were firmly establishing their trading communities at Joal and Porto Real. The writer is the same Vicar who, 2 years later, sent a party from Cachao to demand of the king of Joal that he hand over his Jews to the Inquisitions. The king refused in no certain uncertain terms. Remember, we read that in the last two chapters, that was an African king that would not release his Jews to the Portuguese, and he even threatened them, like, hey, you're going to lose your heads behind this. We will kill you. You know, he basically said that. It says here, this passage links beyond a shadow of doubt the Jews of the Petite Cote to the weapons trade. A report by the Jesuit missionary Father Manuel Alvarez, written in about 1615, identifies another recipient of almas brancas. Father Alvarez, referring to the immensely wealthy King of Busas, ruler of a small coastal state south of Cachao, described the merchandise this man received from the Europeans and Lakatos. As for weapons apart from the cannon given him by his admirer, he has muskets, espadas, and trocados. Indeed, he had a depot of all kinds of weapons. Not coincidentally, the King of Busas was the largest slave trader along this part of the coast. It is clear from these sources that in order to obtain slaves from the King of Busas, it was necessary to offer long swords and trocados. According to Alvarez, one Antonio Nunez was a Lankado who purchased slaves from the king. Certainly, the Senegambian Antonio Nunez was one of the numerous new Christian and Jewish Lankados working with the magnates of the Atlantic trade. The geopolitical context, Morocco after 1578. A concentration of the late 16th and early 17th century documents clearly shows that the coastal trade in almas brancas to Senegambia attained significant proportions in the 30 years beginning shortly before 1590. Does this process simply reflect a gradual and steady increase in demand commensurate with the growth of European trade with Senegambia? Or did historical circumstances specific to this period create a situation in which demand for swords and daggers suddenly spiked? The wider economic and political context connecting West Africa to Morocco and to Europe suggests that there was, in fact, a sudden increase in demand for arms along the Upper Guinea coast and in the interior. It seems likely that about 1590 increased demand for almas brancas in the interior of Senegambia and the Sahel also played a major role in the rapid expansion of weapons trade. Historical circumstances including the Moroccan invasion of Songhai in 1591, disrupted the military and political balance of power from Northern Sahara to the inland delta of the Niger River. These factors combined with steadily increasing demands for weapons among the Wolofs and their southern neighbors along the coast of Senegambia caused a rapid increase in production and export of almas brancas from Lisbon and from northern Europe. In Morocco, immediately after the Sultan Ahmed Mansur crushed the Portuguese army at Kibar in 1578, he set out to build a modern armaments industry. As Antonio, a Portuguese hostage of Al-Mansur, who resided in Marrakesh from 1592 to 1606, observed large numbers of captured European artisans were brought to that city. Then they enjoyed better treatment than had been there in a lot in Europe. They worked for the new ruler, and their artistry now served to grace Al-Mansur's court. There arrived in Marrakesh masters of all skills who, through the great projects that the Sharifi undertook, embellished his entire realm. Al-Mansur's new armament industry produced both artillery and high-quality short swords for cavalry. The design of these weapons was entrusted to European masters. And skilled workmen were chosen among the young soldiers who had been captured at Al-Qasr Kabir. He built a casa de armas to produce large quantities of escopetas, or espadas, and all of the outfitting for horses, all to perfection. And all of these workshops were run by great masters of the craft, English, Flemish, and French. And the officers in the workshops were the youths captured in battle, whom the sheriff ordered to serve in his workshop. Thus, before he invaded Songhai, Mansur expanded and updated his production of cavalry weapons, availing himself of the latest in European military technology. The invasion and conquest of Songhai in 1591 brought an influx of thousands of weapons, both firearms and almas brancas, into the Sahel. The direct impact of Al-Mansur's well-armed soldiers was clear following the Sadian victory of the Battle of Tondibi. Repercussions from the Moroccan invasion must have extended throughout the Sahel, resulting in an increased demand for cavalry weapons, especially short swords, throughout the region. During the long Moroccan occupation of Songhai that ensued, those new weapons remained in the Sahel. The implantation of Moroccan and later armor control in the trading centers of the inland delta of the Niger inevitably caused these blade weapons to spread throughout the region. Increased demand will have quickly extended throughout the former Shanghai Empire and the Monday trade diaspora, which extended westward along the Gambia River to the Senegambian coast. There, the Atlantic trade would have provided a ready second source of weapons. Meanwhile, along the coast, a similar rising demand for blade weapons was being felt at exactly the same time. Initially, weapons of Moroccan manufacture were transported across the Sahara directly from Marrakesh. But the regional demand would have quickly outstripped Moroccan supply, especially after the death of Al-Mansur in 1603 and the ensuing years of famine, epidemic, and civil strife that weakened and eventually destroyed the Sasanian dynasty. In the Niger Valley from Djenai to Gao, the rising demand for modern armor blancas would have had to be satisfied by other sources. This, in turn, must have occasioned a further increase in demand for weapons along the Atlantic coast. Indeed, Inquisition sources imply that swords from the coast were traded east into the Muslim areas. It may be that some weapons were traded far east into the Sahel, as contemporary Portuguese and Dutch sources clearly indicate. By the second decade of the 17th century, the Atlantic trade from Europe to West Africa had expanded to meet this demand for weapons. Growing European commercial competition along the Upper Guinea coast at the turn of the 17th century, combined with the interruption of the trade to Morocco, meant that not only the Portuguese, but also Dutch and English merchants, and probably French as well, trading growing quantities of blade weapons in Guinea. This situation, combined with the continued importation of horses and the consequent demand for weapons appropriate for cavalry, made the decades immediately after 1590 a time of explosive growth in sword, dagger, and espada trade. The date of the two Inquisitions reports from Lisbon is not a coincidence. The earlier document reflects the existence of a strong demand for steel weapons along the Upper Guinea coast in the last decades of the 16th century. The 1618 report illustrates a second stage in which the demand for these weapons extended for 1,000 miles into the Sahel. By the 1620s, if not before, the two trading routes bringing weapons to West Africa, the Trans-Saharan route from Morocco and the coastal trade from Europe, intersected in the interior of Senegambia. In 1621, the English merchant Richard Jobson encountered a Jahanki trader from 460 miles upriver along the Gambia. Bakasano wore a sword that he had obtained from an Arabic trader. Sano described the trans-desert commerce to his English visitor. This trade, he asserted, brought the Moors of Barbary within 6 days' march of the Upper Gambia. I took some special note of the blade of his sword and a pair of brass bracelets one of his wives had upon her arms, both which things appear to me to be such a might very well be brought in their beginnings, either from London or some other part of this our native country. I demanded of him where he had them. He made answers there was a people used to come amongst him, whom they called Arabics, who brought them these and diverse other commodities. We asked what manner of people. He described the tawny Moor unto us and said they came in great companies together and with many camels. This his relation made it certain that these were the Moors of Barbary, the discovery of whose trade and traffic was the ground of this our being so high in the river. The specific description of the sword blade, such as might be brought from London, is significant. As early as 1589, English traders were exporting sword blades, among other weapons, to Morocco. And English masters were among the experts who had been contracted by Al-Mansur. It was not by chance that the Trans-Saharan and Atlantic trade routes met along the Gambia, for it was also here that both routes came in contact with the Monday trading network. But what had led the Englishmen to search the Upper Gambia for this trade and traffic? The English may have acquired this information from the Portuguese partners, the Lancanos, on the Petit Coat, who had regular commercial ties to the Gambia. The specific timing of Jobson's travel may also reflect contact with the missions of Samuel and Joseph Palach in 1614 to 1615. And 4 years later, might not Joseph Palach in 1619 have shared information about the trans-Saharan commerce with members of the Royal Company of Adventurers to Africa? In the coastal Senegambia, the increased demand among local populations for iron weapons as well as for iron with which to make both weapons and agricultural instruments has recently been documented by Walter Hawthorne. In his historical study of the Balanta peoples of Guinea-Bissau, as Hawthorne argues, this demand was closely linked to the growth of the Atlantic slave trade, against which local populations sought to protect themselves by migration or by obtaining increased defensive capability. Why would they need to buy more swords? Because now you have slave raiders. A lot of these Africans were slave raiders, and they wanted to have, you know, a weapon on them. They wanted to have a sword on them so they could protect their families. Right, we read another book on a prior show, might have been a year ago, about where slave raiding was real bad. Native Africans would put bombardments around their house to protect themselves from slave raiders. Right, so if they're in their house sleeping, they don't get snatched up. Right here says Hawthorne's convincing analysis of the importance of iron imports for coastal societies explains part, but not all, of the almost insatiable demand for iron weapons. Broader geopolitical developments, including the Moroccan invasion of Songhai and its impact throughout the inland delta of the Niger, also served to stimulate the demand for weapons of both European and North African manufacture. And we know that Songhai Empire, what they, the edict that they produced to ban Jews from that, from the Niger loop as well. Very, very important times of history, and epochs of time here in West Africa. It says the rapidity of the European merchants' response to this demand is not surprising. The Lisbon New Christians were connected to an international commercial network based in part upon family ties to Jewish merchants in Italy, the Low Countries, and Morocco. Those family ties, the result of migration following the Spanish expulsion of 1492 and the Portuguese forced conversion of 1496 to 1497, were maintained throughout the 16th century. Production and export of blade weapons from Morocco were facilitated by commercial information that filtered from Lisbon to Marrakesh via the same family networks. Within Europe, these networks enabled new Christian and Jewish merchants in Portugal and Northern Europe, as well as Protestant merchants in Holland, France, and England, to respond almost immediately to the expanding sub-Saharan demand for armas brancas. As Moroccan production and export of weapons diminished following the death of Almanzar in 1603, Jewish merchants from Morocco, men such as Samuel and Joseph Palachi, exchanged commercial information with relatives in Portugal and in the Netherlands. New Christian traders in Lisbon and Jewish merchants in Amsterdam were thus able to respond to the decreasing Moroccan production of blade weapons by rapidly increasing their own share of the weapons trade to West Africa. From the perspective of La Longue Durée, the history of the supply of weapons to Upper Guinea coast and to the Sahelian hinterland reflects a dynamic constellation of commercial, political, and military factors in these two regions and in Morocco. Even though specific events such as Almanzar's invasion of Songhai immediately affected the Sahelian market for blade weapons, long-term factors such as the importation of horses from the Sahara and after 1450 through the Atlantic trade greatly increased the demand for short swords to be used as cavalry weapons. The blade weapons trade from Europe was firmly established by 1590 and possibly much earlier. Demand continued to grow over the next three decades, first in response to Moroccan invasion of Songhai, and after 1603, as a result of the political chaos in Morocco and the disruption of the Western Trans-Saharan trade in the aftermath of Almanzar's death. We're 151 pages in, and we just finished chapter 4 dealing with the sword trade between Europe, Morocco, and Senegambia and other coastal West African peoples. And as we see, the local Africans were involved. Africans were buying swords and they were buying weaponry for several reasons. In response, as we just read, to the Songhai invasion of the Songhai Empire, also protecting themselves from slave raiders and war, and some people just getting into war and dominate other African tribes, as we read. So great chapter, great tidbit of historical information there. So let's move on to chapter 5. Like I said, we're going to finish this book. We're going to finish this book. I don't know how y'all let somebody that work as many hours as me read more books to y'all. I don't know how y'all do it. Anyway. Chapter 5. The Luso-African ivories as historical sources for the weapons trade and for the Jewish presence in Guinea of Cape Verde. Objects of material culture are documents of their time and place. Artifacts, just as much as written sources, provide information and insight into historical events. In addition, they serve as graphic evidence of contact among different cultures, illustrating trade networks and shedding light on the accompanying exchange of technology and even of ideas. Images and the symbolism that they encompass and express may give voice to concepts and even to beliefs that are not readily committed to or expressed in writing. The object, when situated and interpreted within the specific cultural and historical context that engendered it, complements and enriches the study of more traditional historical documents, such as travel narratives and archival records. Material culture, therefore, can be crucial to the study of history of cultural and religious interactions. And you know what's important, what's so glaringly obvious about that? Like, material culture shows you so much. So when again, like when we talk about the Bantus, it's a sidebar. They having coconuts and they having bananas and other things that, you know, iron smelting ability, you know, 3,000 years ago. And that those are key points that's showing you the chickens and whatnot, showing you that these people, where they derived from, right? But that's for a whole nother video. Anyway, today, approximately 150 artworks have been identified by scholars as belonging to the corpus of carved ivories from West Africa. Although they are usually referred to as Afro-Portuguese ivories, these pieces are more appropriately referred to as Luso-African ivories. The latter term reflects their creation by West African sculptors working within Africa. The objects, although hybrid in inspiration, are far more African and Portuguese. No documentary evidence exists to indicate that any of the ivories were carved by African artists living in Portugal. West African artists create the sculptures within the context of their own cultures. Nevertheless, the artists clearly were responding to a Creole or a Luso-African culture presence. Many of the carvings were made for these commercial middlemen and for visiting European merchants. They reflect the close commercial relationship that existed between West Africans, Luso Africans, and Europeans. Remember, you know, a lot of people try to single out what one group. Oh, the Europeans did this, that, and the third. No, they all have played a part in this trade, man. Right? It says both the chronology and the geographical origins of these works are subject to scholarly dispute. The early works are universally and correctly attributed to the Sapis people of Sierra Leone, an identification that is well documented in early 16th century Portuguese sources. The most widely accepted hypothesis that works produced after 1550 came not from Sierra Leone, but from the Nigerian Kingdom of Benin, has recently been shown to be unlikely indeed. The Benin label must be considered highly dubious in view of abundant contemporary documentation in Portuguese sources, namely in accounts of Doneja, Manuel Alvarez, and Francisco de Lemos Correjo, that describes an ongoing act of Sierra Leonean ivory carving industry. The Luso-African ivories were produced continuously in Sierra Leone throughout the 16th and 17th century, and few, if any, of the carvings come from Nigeria. The work is of direct relevance to the ivory and weapons trade to and from Upper Guinea. The work is direct relevance to the ivory and weapons trade to and from Upper Guinea. The art historical reassessment of the dating and provenance of the ivories is recent and has only begun to register in museum catalogs. Therefore, the basic historical arguments for the reinterpretation will be presented below. The reassessment of the ivories, particularly a small group of the vessels known as salieros or salt sellers, that depict armed Portuguese soldiers and cavalrymen, is of particular relevance to the weapons trade. These salt sellers provide direct evidence of some of the weapons discussed in the previous chapter. They serve to document the commerce that involved both Jewish and New Christian producers in Europe, as well as Jewish merchants in Senegambia. By the early 1460s, Portuguese commerce extended southeast to the region subsequently known by the Portuguese as Sierra Leoa, or simply the Serra. The term Sierra Leoa included the coast northward through much of present-day Guinea-Conakry. Thus, the Sierra Leoa, identified as a provenance for the Luso-African ivory, should not be confused with the more limited geographical area of the coastal Sierra Leone. Shortly after 1600, a Portuguese Jesuit mission was established in Guinea and headquartered in the Cape Verde Islands. Plagued by frightfully high mortality, the Jesuits never managed to settle more than two missionaries at a time in Sierra Leoa. Their mainland mission was abandoned shortly after the death of Father Manuel Alvarez in 1616, and the remaining mission in the islands was abandoned in 1642. This missionary presence is historically important because several Jesuits who survived longer than a few months left written records. Their narratives are a rich source of firsthand information about coastal society at the beginning of the 17th century. These sources complement the better-known texts of the late 16th century Cape Verdean Portuguese merchants Andre Donelha and Andre Alvarez de Almeida. Together, these authors provide a wealth of information about local African societies and material culture. If Portuguese settlers, let me write that real quick. I know it's going to make some Africans mad that Jesuits give us insight on West African history. I had to highlight that real quick. It says if Portuguese settlers and their Euro-African descendants bridged European and African culture, so too did some local African rulers and a few healthy African traders. As I said, local Africans play a pivotal role in this. It says African merchants and local rulers showed an astonishing capacity to assimilate elements of European culture. Some of them spoke European languages and lived in Portuguese-style houses. A few had converted to Christianity. One even constructed a chapel for visiting Portuguese traders. The wealthiest among them filled these houses with furniture, rugs, clothing, and table settings worthy of European royalty. The most extraordinary examples was de Sebastião, King of Busses, a small state in present-day Guinea-Bissau, located south of the 17th century Portuguese trading settlement of Cachao. The Jesuit missionary Manuel Alvarez, writing in the period 1609 to 1613, described the ruler's unparalleled wealth. Within his house, he keeps many trunks and boxes full of different articles of clothing, such as very elaborate smocks, doublets, and breeches, sheets, coverlets, and canopies made in silk, and items in gold and silver. These items he has brought and continues to buy from Portuguese who come there with their ships to obtain slaves. I have already mentioned the king's gold, silver, etc. He keeps his table with silver tableware and a silver water jug, additionally gilded. The table linen is very rich and varied like the rest of the table set. He possesses tapestries, decorations and leather, carpets, a fine wardrobe. As for weapons, apart from the cannon given him by his admirer, he has muskets, swords, and daggers. The king has his own house in which he sleeps, and this is a very large one, like the best situated ones in Cachao. Clearly, the ruler of Busses has surrounded himself with trappings of European material, culture worthy of a European ruler. Alvarez recounts that the king's Portuguese major domo almost bought him a writing desk from China. Yet even without this treasure, the man's possessions included luxury items from throughout the Portuguese Empire. Whereas his clothing was European, some of the silk and the tapestries came from Asia. And this ruler was not the only wealthy African to amass cultural artifacts from a global empire. Toward the end of the century, the French merchant Michael Jalalet traveled south through the Gambia at the trading communities of Georgia. He met the local ruler, Guereguia. He met the local ruler whose daughter was a Christian married to a European. The king of Guereguia had on a Portuguese cap and an African robe. In his hand, he carried a Spanish-style sword upon which he leaned. After greeting us, he bid us enter his house. His house is built in the Portuguese style. We found lunch waiting. He joined us to eat, as did his wife, which showed me that in this place they have begun to take on English manners. From European manners to Portuguese-style houses to material possessions accumulated from throughout the Portuguese commercial empire, these African merchants and rulers assimilated elements of global material culture. It is likely that some members of this African elite also acquired ivories to complement their gold, silver, and silk possessions. The King of Busis was, in fact, involved in the ivory trade to the Petit Coat. On April 30th, 1612, Luis Fernandez, one of the Jewish traders in João, wrote him a letter. The king was literate. Duarte, who was careful to sign his Christian name rather than his Jewish name, Joshua Israel, proposed that the king provide him with slaves, ivory, and gold as trade goods, which he was to send by boat directly from Busis to Rufis. In return, Duarte offered horses, iron, and textiles. Duarte also invited the king to send his own son to live with him, presumably to be trained as a commercial agent. Virtually nothing from the material culture of this local African elite has survived, not even the architecture remains. Given the fragility of ivory spoons and vessels, and in view of the fact that even among the ivories that entered European at an early date, only an estimated 4 to 10% have survived. It is hardly surprising that no physical evidence of this internal African market for ivory carvings exists today. In the half century since Afro-Portuguese ivories were first described by Fahig, however you say his name, the dating of these important works has remained problematic. In fact, a radical discrepancy has developed between the work of the art historians and that of the historians. Since 1975, both the publications of highly relevant historical documents and the reinterpretation of early historical theories about 16th century Sierra Leone have been largely ignored by art historians who have written about the ivories. The first Luso-African ivories arrived in Europe toward the end of the 15th century. This fact is beyond dispute. Iconographic elements in the works themselves, along with indisputable documentary evidence, firmly established the date. The terminus for the production of the ivories, however, has been subject to significant disagreement. Art historians in their wake, numerous museum curators have dated the works from Sierra Leone to the period of 1490 to 1530, or 1490 to 1550. An early and less known essay by Grossinelli proposed by the dating 1460 to 1560. Bassani and Cornell have argued that even though some ivory carvings continue to reach Europe until the beginning of the 17th century, these latter works were produced not in Sierra Leone, but rather in Benin, which is southwestern Nigeria. Portuguese sources from the beginning of the 16th century firmly document the production and export of ivory carvings from Sierra Leone. Customs records from the Costa de Guinea, dating from 1504, 1505, and preserved in the National Archives in Lisbon, cite the importation of dozens of ivory spoons and of at least 3 salieros, or salt cellars. The ships had sailed from Elmina on the Gold Coast, but as the historians Alan Ryder and Avelino da Mota have pointed out, these vessels also transported rice, implying that they had stopped in the rice-producing area of Sierra Leone. Parenthetically, the customs records refer to the Cojones de Marfi. The modern Portuguese orthography is Cojones de Marfi. Also in 1505, Duarte, who would later serve as Capitão Mor at Almena, wrote Esmeralda de Cito Orbis, which incorporates a description of the Bulum peoples of the Sierra Leone. The largest group of inhabitants of this land are called Bulos, a warlike people who are rarely at peace. In this land, they make very clever spoons of ivory, the best finished works that there are in any of these parts. At least one of the Portuguese who brought ivory spoons through the Lisbon Customs House in 1505, Diego Lopes, was also a capitão at Elmina. One wonders whether the two men had communicated about the trade in ivory carvings. Pachechos Pereira's contemporary Valentin Fernandez, a German-born geographer living in Portugal, never visited Africa, but his account is based on information provided by traders familiar with the Guinea of Cape Verde. Fernandez writes, "In Sierra Leone, the men are extremely subtle and ingenious. They fashion works of ivory that are very wonderful to see. of all things that they are asked to make, to wit, some make spoons, other make salt cellars, and other make handles for daggers and any other subtlety. The ivories from Sierra Leone are commonly dated to the period of 1490 to 1550. Although no documentary evidence for this artistic cutoff date exists, it is argued that local Sapi society was destroyed and ivory production ended by the invasion of the coast of coastal Sierra Leone by people called the Mandis. The 1970 writing of the historian Walter Rodney is often cited as a source for the Mani invasions. But West Africa historians have largely discredited the theory of a cataclysmic invasion. This reassessment dates to an article published by Adam Jones in 1981. Jones cast doubt on the theory of devastating invasion, suggesting rather a gradual and one-man firm, far less disruptive, migration toward the West by the Mandi-speaking Manes, who were actually Va. Jones observes that oral traditions often recast gradual historical processes as sudden cataclysmic events. He observes that it is the kind of picture oral traditions tend to give. Historical processes lasting decades or centuries are best explained and memorized in terms of a single battle or the action of one leader. Early 17th century Portuguese narratives do refer to an invasion. However, the descriptions of cannibal armies destroying Sapi's culture are, as a critical reading of these sources shows, highly exaggerated and misleading. The nightmare account by the Jesuit missionary Manuel Alvarez describes waves of warriors eating their way across the African continent. However, Father Alvarez, who lived in Sierra Leone half a century after the alleged attack, firmly contradicts his own account of the invasion. He specifically likens the situation circa 1612 between the recently conquered Sapis and their suddenly docile conquerors to that prevailing between the Mandinka and the Suniki in the Gambia. The Mandinka and the Suniki are two closely related groups, differentiated primarily by the religion. The Mandinka are Muslims who live in harmony for centuries after the supposed Mandi invasion. The parallel is historically appropriate. In both instances, the invasion described in local oral traditions was actually a gradual process of migration and cultural assimilation. The early history of European collecting of the Luso-African ivories confirms this doubt. West African ivories were imported into Europe throughout the 16th century and into the 17th century, and not just in the period of to 1550. The Munich, founded by Albrecht V of Bavaria, he reigned 1550 to 1579, was collected after 1550. The Kunstkammern of the Habsburgs, which includes several important Luso-African ivories, were also assembled during the second half of the 17th century. The mid-17th century African collection amassed by the German merchant Christoph Weichmann from Ulm also includes several carved ivory spoons. While the provenance of these spoons is not established, they were undoubtedly collected, as Adam Jones has demonstrated, shortly after 1650. It is unlikely that these fragile and rather exotic items were simply being traded across Europe for a century after they ceased being made. The continued importation of the sculptures into the 17th century Europe strongly suggests that ivory spoons continued to be produced long after 1550. This demand must have encouraged the continuation of the local Sapi's carving traditions. Bassani and Cornell account for a continued ivory production by arguing that European imports from Sierra Leone were replaced by carvings from Benin after 1530, or in accord with the Mani invasions thesis after 1550. The argument faces several problems. First, the earliest written reference to ivory carvings from Benin dates to 1588. And as Stefan Eisenhofer points out, it is not all clear that even this reference by an English ship captain named James Wells refers specifically to Benin. Second, as Alan Ryder observes in his study of Europeans in Benin, the ivory trade between Portugal and Benin did not exist during the 70 years preceding the 1588 reference. This is precisely the period when Benin is hypothesized to have exported ivory carvings. Third, Portuguese trading visits to Benin, which lay inland and was not accessible to seaborne vessels appear to have ceased to become quite rare after 1535, and it's difficult to see how the Portuguese could have been obtaining ivory spoons and salt cellars from Benin at a time when they were rarely visiting the kingdom. Bassani's methodology is neither historically nor art historically convincing. His argument that ivories were produced in Sierra Leone only from 1490 to 1530 is based not on documentary sources, but rather on the dubious grounds that the European iconographic elements can all be dated to the last quarter of the 15th century and the first quarter of the 16th century. In fact, if foreign iconographic elements all date to 1490 and 1525, this proves only that the ivories could not have been made earlier than that date. It does not by any means rule out a later date. Bassani argues that only a small number of artists were active in Sierra Leone. This claim is disproved by the recent publication of the late 16th century inventories from South German collections. These lists show a loss of 90% of the ivories over the intervening centuries. Existing ivories represent less than 10% and perhaps little as 4% of the objects acquired 4 centuries ago. The loss was probably significantly higher among objects that never entered princely collections, such as numerous spoons imported by Portuguese sailors and listed in the 1505 custom records. In addition, Valentin Fernandez's description of the Sapis makes it clear, at least in the first decade of the 16th century, there were more than a few carvers, and that the artists specialized some produced spoons, other salt cellars, and steel other dagger handles or other objects. Hence the argument that there were only as many artists could have produced the known ivories cannot be sustained. In our view, with the exception of some of the spoons, convincing evidence of Benin origin does not exist. Furthermore, in light of this extensive trade in blade weapons discussed in the previous chapter, some of the salt cellars and at least some of the spoons contain iconographic elements that are consistent with an origin in Sierra Leone rather than Nigeria. The provenance of post-1550 Luso African ivories can ultimately be established only by historical documents. This documentation exists, and it proves that in Sierra Leone, Sapis artists continued to carve ivory spoons and other items into the 17th century. Manuel Alvarez, the Jesuit missionary who lived in Sierra Leone from 1607 to 1616, describes the creation of these works in his Ethiopian Menorah. Father Alvarez's comments about ivory production are crucial. He lived on the coast and was familiar with local society. His description firmly documents the survival of ivory carving 65 years after the Mani invasion. The original manuscript of Ethiopian Menorah, actually an 18th century copy, was transcribed at Texeria de Mota and translated into English by P.E.H. Hare. In the following commentary, Hare's translation is cited, except where we wish to comment on Alvarez's use of specific words that relate to sculpture and aesthetics. There, the original Portuguese manuscript is cited. Alvarez described the many diverse people living in the vicinity of the Portuguese trading center of Matombo. Each group included Timnis and Sapis, whose country only survives in part, speaks its own language. He continues, because of their ability and intelligence, some of them have a gift of artistic imagination, and they carve in wood images of their dead, which they call Seraph, and various other figures which are found all over their boats. The variety of their handicrafts is due to their artistry. They make tagaras, large wooden dishes in different sizes of unusual and pleasing design, which are here used at table, spoons made of ivory, beautifully finished, the handles carved, and entertaining shapes such as heads of animals, birds, and their own idols, all done with such perfection that it has to be seen to be believed. In some, they are in their own way skilled at the handicrafts. Alvarez is absolutely clear. In 1615, the Sapis were still highly skilled artists. They continued to carve ivory spoons with great skill long after the invasion or migration of the preceding century. Furthermore, the description of the decorated handles perfectly fits surviving spoons, some of which have been attributed to the Benin. The description of large wooden bulls might fit salt cellars too. The original manuscript reads, some of which are large dishes of wood, most unusual and beautiful, and that here are used at a table, of which some are rather small, others larger. These vessels are not made of ivory. Nevertheless, the artistic talent and requisite technical skill, would have been similar to both ivory and wood. It may be that ivory bowls were still being produced in 1615, but only for export. The ivory trade and the weapons trade represented in ivory. By the early 17th century, throughout Guinea and the Cape Verde, from Senegambia to Sierra Leone, the ivory trade had grown to sizable proportions. Jewish merchants in Amsterdam and on the Petite Côte played a dominant role in commerce. So y'all can write that down too. Ivory trade, wax, gold, slaves, and weapons. You can all write that down. They were all known to trade that, right, in West Africa. During the second decade of the century, ivory ranked with wax and hides as the primary goods exported from Joal and Porto Real. This is significant because it reflects the importance of trading goods other than slaves, a factor often overlooked by historians of the 17th century West Africa. Thus, commercial records from the period 1611 to 1615 refer to huge quantities of animal skins and to significant amounts of ivory. These records, however, rarely mention slaves among the exports. In 1615, for example, Gaspar Fernandez brought 3,044 Guinean hides back to Amsterdam along with ivory, but no slaves. We agree with historian Tobias Green, who argues that ivory along with hides were far more important than slaves among exports from the Petite Côte. As I highlight that one right there. In 1611, one merchant in Amsterdam held 2,000 pounds of ivory as a surety for a loan. Portuguese archives confirm the importance of ivory exports at this time. In Senegambia, the Jewish merchants obtained their ivory both from Africans and from new Christian Lakatos. The Lakatos had established contact with Dutch Jews as soon as the latter settled in Senegal, which strongly suggests pre-existing contact. And they all trade in hides and wax and ivory, which they buy there from local non-Christian Africans and from white men who are Cristados nobles, and they deliver the goods to Flanders where they have commercial contact. The Dutch Jews of the Petite Côte used their contacts with relatives who were not public Jews established at the Portuguese settlement at Cachao. But they also traded directly with African middlemen on the coast southeast of Cachao. This commerce is illustrated in a letter from Joshua Israel to Sebastião, king of Busses. In addition, there was a Dutch trading post in Sierra Leone on the Rio de Galinas. There, the traders from the Petite Côte would have had direct commercial access to Sapi's ivory production. Several of the salt sellers depict blade weapons ranging in size from daggers to full swords. These images illustrate the trade in armas brancas to Guinea. Both foot soldiers and horsemen are shown armed with swords and daggers. These are precisely the weapons that were traded to the Upper Guinea coast by the Portuguese merchants during the last decades of the 16th and first two decades of the 17th century. A late 16th or early 17th century date for some of the salt sellers is consistent with the chronology of the ivories, especially as revised in the light of the later Portuguese sources cited previously. The images of soldiers and cavalrymen illustrate daggers and short swords. Parenthetically, it is important to note that in the travel narratives and archival records, we have found no reference to any blade weapon trade linking Portugal or Amsterdam to late 16th or early 17th century Nigeria. These images serve as documentation of commerce and armor brancas. At the same time, the material which the sculptures are made attest to the complementary trade in ivory. Furthermore, some dagger handles were made by Sapi's ivory carvers, thereby combining the production and trade of ivory and of weapons. One could say that in this art form, ivory documents its own role as an item of commerce. A salt seller in the Museum of Art in Lisbon portrays two mounted cavalrymen who carried daggers. This piece is perhaps most noteworthy for its strange horses with their dog-like heads and crocodile-like teeth, suggesting that the artist had never seen a real horse. One horseman holds the reins in his left hand and a very short sword, really more of a dagger in his right hand. The weapon has a simple and unembellished handle. The other rider holds the handle of a broken sword in his raised right hand. The handle is globe-shaped with scallop sides. Certainly the first warrior's weapons represent a dagger. A Portuguese soldier would have held the short weapon in his left hand. It is unfortunate that the other weapon is broken. One cannot say whether it represented a typical cavalry weapon, the tocado, or a longer sword. So that's the art that was just mentioned on the right of the cavalry men and the men with weapons. All right, let's keep going. Several other salt cellars, including one at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, another in the British Museum, and a third in the National Museum of Copenhagen, depict Portuguese soldiers armed with swords. The length of the blades on several of the weapons correspond to the 77-centimeter long espadas or tocados. The famous piece in the British Museum, in which the bowl is topped by a sailing ship that is in turn crowned by crow's nest with a head just peering over the rim, was previously identified as Benny Portuguese. This salt cellar should be reattributed to the Sapis. The standing Portuguese soldiers are armed with swords that, if drawn to scale, are the correct length of the for tocados. The salt cellar in the Metropolitan Museum of Art is also mislabeled as Benny Portuguese, Edo peoples. It too should be reattributed to the Sapis of Sierra Leone. The lower segment of this carving represents four standing soldiers, Europeans by their features and clothing, two of whom are depicted in profile and two frontally. All four rest their left hand on the hilt of the sword. The weapons are attached to their left hip. The frontally depicted soldiers also wear upside down crosses around their necks. The swords, if drawn to scale, will be 2 or 2.5 feet long, once again, the proper length for tocados. The hilts consist of scallop, bulb, and a single guard, both stylistically and in portrayal of Europeans and their weapons. This ivory is very close to the salt cellar in Copenhagen. The carving in Copenhagen's National Museum depicts four mounted horsemen armed with a variety of weapons. The treatment of the surface patterning of clothing and helmets resembles the New York piece. The faces with deeply incised details for the eyes and the beards closely resemble the figures in the New York ivory. One of the cavalrymen of the Danish ivory wields a sword in his upraised right hand. Its nasty curved blade would be slightly more than 2 feet long, assuming the horseman to be about 5 feet 6 inches tall. This too is correct length for an espada. The hilt was a single semicircular guard that ends in a bulbous projection. Crowning this ivory atop of the spherical vessel, a fifth horseman holds a gun. Sheathed on his right hip are what appear to be their small size, eliminates all detail, a powder horn and a short dagger. This carving entered the Danish royal collection in 1674. Its age at the time and its earlier provenance are not known. One can, however, observe that the artist may have been working from a life model. In particular, the horses are far more realistically portrayed than the strange animals in the Lisbon piece. And to the left, you guys can actually see this piece here that's being described here in the book. The Portuguese soldiers on horseback with the weapons. It says here, for the Sapis artist, what was the significance of these soldiers? We would suggest that the standing figures on the New York and London salt cellars conflate the roles of Portuguese soldiers, merchant, and even the cross displayed prominently on their chest, missionary, to create images of wealth and power. In addition, the use of one trade item, ivory, to depict another weapons is an intentional allusion to the commerce that was an important source of wealth to both parties, and that at the same time brought local African rulers the means of securing military and political power. Depictions of cavalrymen with daggers Portuguese soldiers with short swords are visual documentation of weapons trade, much of which was in the hands of Jewish merchants. The role played in this commerce by new Christian Portuguese weapons contractors and by Jewish merchants based in Amsterdam, as well as by Portuguese Lencados in Sierra Leone, some of whom were themselves new Christians, raises an interesting question. Might the iconography of some Irish reflect a Jewish or crypto-Jewish role in their patronage? Comparison to artworks produced in other parts of the Portuguese commercial empire may help shed light on this problem. In India, where new Christians were also actively involved in Portugal's overseas trade, art historical evidence of possible crypto-Jewish symbolism does exist. There, as Marcus Newark has argued, a group of Indo-Portuguese ivories suggests an iconographic dualism. This dualism, ostensibly Christian, but very possibly concealing another Jewish meaning, is characteristic of crypto-Jewish religious practices as they evolve under the imminent threat of the Inquisition. The role of the new Christian Lencados would have been particularly important in this respect. These men played a central role in the ivory trade and intermediaries between African producers and traders and European merchants. I'm thinking, before I continue reading, I'm thinking that these men, these Sephardic men, are the reason why those crosses was upside down being depicted the way they were. But we'll find out. It says here, it was they who acquired the finished works from the Sapis ivory carvers. For specific objects, iconographic programs were stipulated by European patrons, sometimes using important images such as engravings to convey a visual model to the Sapis artists. The Lencados would have served as intermediaries here too in conveying the patrons' desires. Is a hidden Jewish presence to be found in any other side piece of ivories? Such symbolism would necessarily be difficult to identify 4 centuries after the works were produced, as it would likely be hidden behind a double iconography. In the cultural and historical context that lent meaning to this symbolism is no longer accessible today. One of the surviving ivory carvings is of particular interest as the possible embodiment of dual iconography. The object in question is a carved ivory spoon with a decorated handle in the collection of the Volkerkunde Museum in Vienna. It is probably one of the 6 surviving spoons from a 1596 inventory of the Kunstkammer at Schloss Ambras. The inventory lists the spoons together without describing individual pieces, and all of them were misidentified as Turkish in style. The handle of the spoon depicts 2 stylized birds with long beaks, one atop the other. The lower bird holds a fish in its long bill. The handle of the spoon culminates in the right hand. The index finger and middle finger are extended, while the thumb and the 4th and 5th fingers are bent to cover the palm. At first impression, the image looks like a hand raised in a sacerdotal blessing. But this hand may possibly have had a very different significance. It is conceivable that the spoon was actually a religious object, specifically a Torah pointer or puntero, an implement for turning the Torah scroll. In Hebrew, the pointer is known as a yad or hand. All right. A brief history of the puntero. Torah pointers serve an important ritual function. They enable the reader of the sacred text to observe the prohibition against touching the scroll with one's bare hand. The earliest Torah pointer in Europe, according to a historical study by Naomi Fetchwanger-Sarik, dates to the late 15th century and comes from northern Italy. Only a small number of pre-17th century pointers have survived. By the early 1600s, the yad or yadam was just coming into use in the Portuguese community of Amsterdam. Indeed, several belong to Beth Israel Synagogue, where the earliest inventory dates to 1619. Most punteros shared several basic characteristics since the 18th century. Many, but not all, have been made of silver. They have a long handle, and most of them end in the right hand with the index finger extended quite literally pointing. Early yadam, however, show significant variation, including a wide variety of hand gestures. Several show the middle finger extended, and at least one has the entire hand balled into a fist. Wait, the middle finger was extended. I need that piece of art. I think that reflects my values. Anyway, let me get back to this. Other examples show. Oh, let me highlight that, y'all. I'm sorry, y'all. That tickled me for a minute. Hold on. However, show including a wide variety of hand gestures. Several show the middle finger extended, and at least one has the entire hand balled into a fist. Let me get that real quick. I got to save that. That embodies my values right there, man. Anyway, other examples show the thumb and forefinger extended together in a manner that resembles the two extended fingers of the Sierra Leonean ivory. Another Torah pointer depicts the left hand. A wooden yacht from Alsace is embellished with a handle twisted into a spiral-like rope and decorated with geometric motifs, while another Alsatian yacht carved of bone has a handle comprised of two interlocking sea monsters. In other words, Torah pointers are far from exhibiting a standardized form. Three surviving 17th century inventories list ritual objects that belong to the Portuguese synagogue of Beth Israel. The earliest list dates to 1619 and includes one silver pontero. The Portuguese term appears consistently in preference to the Hebrew word yacht. Another inventory from 1620 lists a pontero made of ebony. Like silver, ebony was rare and a valuable material with origins in a distant and tropical land. A third inventory drawn up on the occasion of the merger of Beth Jacob, Neves Shalom, and Beth Israel, 1639, lists six ponteros. One of them is described as a pointer made of coral and decorated with silver. These ponteros are among the earliest known European Torah pointers. The descriptions reflect a diversity of materials, suggesting the artists and patrons had not yet settled on a standardized form for this object. All of them, however, were made of rare and valuable materials imported from the overseas empire. In similar fashion, ivory was a valuable material from the Portuguese/Dutch commercial diaspora. Indeed, the 1619 Amsterdam inventory lists a Megilla made of ivory. The Schloss Amsterdam inventory date of 1596, assuming it does apply to the pointer spoon, rules out any direct connection between the Vienna spoon and the Jewish synagogue at Joal. However, there were Jews living at Joal as early as 1591. It is possible that they held religious services there 2 decades before the arrival of Jacob Pellegrino. Elsewhere, there were numerous new Christians, Lakatos, etc., Leoa, in the late 16th century. Furthermore, there were no representatives of the church in Sierra Leone before the Jesuit mission in 1606. It is possible that these new Christians established a synagogue there. It would certainly have escaped the notice of the Inquisition. Sierra Leone would have been a safe place to be a Jew. And this spoon could possibly have been carved for their use. If a new Christian Lakato living anywhere in Guinea did order a Torah pointer, he would have had to play an active role by providing a verbal description or a sketch of the desired object. Torah pointers traditionally depict the hand with only the first finger extended. This ivory pointer spoon has the index and middle fingers extended together, similar to the Christian blessing. The question of multiple meanings and double function or of hidden symbolism is pertinent. Why disguise a Torah pointer as something else? Specifically as a spoon, and why change the extended index finger to a Christian blessing, particularly when no other ponteros hide their function? The answer is clear. New Christian Lakatos in Guinea of Cape Verde had to be on guard lest they encounter church representatives who might report them to the Inquisition. And if the object in question was to be shipped on a vessel that was not officially registered, then the goods were subject to seizure by the Portuguese authorities. It is not surprising that the resulting carving was both a spoon and a pointing finger, and that the gesture of the hand recalls Catholic benediction. The gesture's double meaning was a form of protection against the danger that the object and its owners might fall into the clutches of the Inquisition. In this respect, the pointer spoon also illustrates an important characteristic of Jewish cultural artifacts from early modern Europe. Jews in the 16th and 17th century Western Europe and crypto-Jews in Iberia and the Portuguese overseas empire did not live in cultural isolation. Rather, they were closely connected to the surrounding Christian community. This was especially true in Portugal. Certainly all crypto Jews who had grown up in Portugal after 1497, as would have been the case for Judaizing Lencados, had assimilated elements of the Catholic religious ritual and belief. It is not surprising that material culture reflects the syncretic nature of Jewish life. Discussing the same phenomenon among 18th century Central European Jewry, Felicitas writes, it is an interaction rooted in multiculturalism of the Jewish diaspora. It can be found in the ideological as well as the material realm, for example, in artifacts. She further agrees that it was common to use symbolic decoration that was meaningful to both Jewish and non-Jewish people. Given all these factors, we may entertain the thought-provoking hypothesis that the ivory pointed spoon is such an object. If this particular piece, not commissioned by new Christian or Jewish Lencados or commercial middlemen, other ivories certainly were, and some of them were likely intended for ritual purposes. The result is a carving whose iconography reflects its complex multicultural origins. The object is a spoon, yet it may have served a hidden ritual function. And it contains symbolism reflecting two and possibly three distinct religious traditions from late 16th century Sierra Leone. The gesture recalls a hand that gives the Christian blessing. The hand may also be a yod, and the carved birds that embellish the handle reflect Father Alvarez's 1615 description of the Sapis ivory spoons. The handles carved in an entertaining shape, such as the heads of animals, and their idols. The animals, birds, and idols are all expressions of the local Sapi's religious symbolism. Carved by Sapi artists in Sierra Leone, ordered by the Portuguese Lencado living in West Africa, conceivably intended for a new Christian crypto-Jewish community in West Africa, but ultimately coming into the possession of a Catholic ruling family in Austria. This spoon and pointing hand incorporate symbolism reflecting the diverse religious traditions of the different parties involved. Postscript. While a possible Jewish ritual function for the ivory spoon may be suggested, a far more important religious object that conceivably came from the Portuguese community on the Petit Côte did ultimately come into the possession of Bet Israel Synagogue in Amsterdam. When Moses de Mesquita arrived in synagogue in 1612, he was 24, 25 years old. After he returned permanently to Amsterdam around 1620, he became a prosperous merchant and a pillar of the Beth Israel community. In 1635, he donated a Torah stroll to the synagogue. Could this not have been a Torah that was used beginning in 1612 in the services of Porta Dial or in Joal in the house of Diogo Vaz de Sousa? So that's chapter 5. All right. Next chapter, 6, is the last chapter in the book, The Later Years of Merchant Immobility, and we're 176 pages in. So we have that. And then we have the conclusion, which I think is, let me see if I can get it real quick. So we're at 176. This chapter will end on page 215, and then the conclusion is a couple pages. So we're almost there. We're in the last stretch. I'm a half step from legendary. All right. Let's get out of here, man. We're done for the day. We are going to finish this book tomorrow. All right. So with that said, I love y'all. I'm glad y'all came by. I appreciate y'all for reaching out. Tomorrow, we're going to read chapter 6. We got something to speak about. Peace to everybody. Yeah. All right. So anyway, I see a lot of people active. I see Rob Bourne in the chat. I see my brother James was in the chat earlier. Emerson says, the vicar of the creator says, great job reading, sir. Shalom to my brother Sean. Each one teaches one of the Balanta tribe got weapon blades from the Jews in West Africa. Yeah, well, we covered that. Rob Bourne is claiming that he gave me this book. No, I bought this book. Anyway. Pseudoscience Universe said, bro, this is a network of families. All the nations mentioned are not different people. As far as race, Jews ruled the last age, black people ruled as all the European nations and much of Africa. I don't get that. I don't understand that. How'd you get that from the book we just read? We're almost done, and by the way, I'm trying to tell you, network Jews, crypto Christians, and Muslims will trade, finance everything, and it's documented they are black for the Neanderthals, for the Netherlands to France, Scotland, Ireland, and England. Did you not hear me read the book? Were you not paying attention? They mentioned the skin color of some of these people. They clearly said some of them were white. Yet your African Jews are black. Come on, brother. Pay attention, man. Pay attention. Shout out to Rob Moore, though, coming by, man. I appreciate you reaching out, but the next episode is something we got to speak about. I've been had this book, man. But I wanted to read it. I wanted to read it live because the Israelites, you got to understand this history of West African Jewry. And you Afrocentrics, Rob Bourne, have to understand this history because it's been blown out of proportion, right? And misrepresented so many times. Anyway, there's that book. Look at those purchases. I buy my books, and I believe in buying books. 296 purchases so far on Google Play. And then I got my Kindle account. So I'm always constantly reading. Shout out to my brother Sean in the building. Yap gang. I don't know how y'all let me outread y'all. And I work so many hours, laborious hours. You guys be on the internet all goddamn day. Why are you not reading more? You would deal with these topics but won't read into the subject matter. Right? So yeah, I'm at 296 books on Google Play. As you can see, I got plenty of books on Sephardic Jews, Jewish culture and society, Jews in the Caribbean, slave owners of West Africa. I might have to read that one live and from cover to cover because it's so many topics that we have to cover. Look, Jewish autonomy and a slave society. I wanted to read a chapter out of this, Jews in the American Slave Trade, because Friedman is trying to argue against the narrative that many people as like Afrocentrics and anti-Semites make about the magnitude of the Jews' involvement in the slave trade. As we read in this book, Rob Bourne, if you're still there, in this book, it clearly shows you that the African rulers were the major players in the slave trade. Was something you guys conveniently not speak on, right? You leave out your special plea. Ashkenazi Jews and the Biblical Israelites. You guys can go look at my playlist. I completed this book. I read this book from cover to cover as well on the channel. This book right here. Look at these prices for this book. This book right here, The World of Ancient Egypt. This is a real good book. I got a video planned that I'm going to deal with this. Ancient Egypt, a lot of these Afrocentrics are misrepresenting ancient Egypt. It's not a matriarchy, right? It tells you the role of women in ancient Egypt. You know, they pretty much took care of the house and child rearing, you know. Hybrid hate, you know, we dived in that book. The Next Sosa, Death of a Nation, I love that book as well. Red Racisms for people that say that communism didn't deal with racism. Well, that's a lie. And this is a great book on this. If you've been following me, you know, this past year, you know I've been referencing black rednecks and white liberals all the time because many of these Afrocentrics are black rednecks. Let the blood stay pure. Talking about Native Indian and African American relationships and how Walter Plecker decided to, he decided to label Indians as Negroes, making them ineligible for, you know, state funds. This is the Cambridge History. This is another expensive book right here, The Cambridge History of Judaism. I think this is volume 7. Jewish Travelers, the Notion. You know, I'm a the Notion de Sosa fan. The Black and the Slaves, a real good book to get an understanding of, Canaanite, the idea that blacks are Canaanites and the idea of black as being Cain and a beast of a field. It's a real good book that describes that. Of course, you got my DNA books, man. Historical geology. I'm a real good, big science guy. African archaeology, Oxford Hammond, that molecular photo fitting. This is the book where Tony Frutiger pretty much entertains the idea that that Eurasian back migration could have been a part, could have been the Bantu expansion coming into Africa as well. Black slave owners of Charleston. Where are the Negroes, their masters? Maurice Fishburg, the Jews, race and environment, our common manners. I got a lot of books, man. I got a lot of books. Again, these are purchases. I own these books. I bought these books. I take this very seriously. Origin, spread of domestication and farming, forensic DNA, blah, blah, blah. Ancient Near Eastern Text, really, another great book, but it's expensive, you know. The Jewish Nation of the Caribbean, Portuguese Style and Luso African Identity, Broken Timelines, The Soul of Judaism, Genealogical Adam and Eve, Substance Dualism, African American South Texas History. I'm trying to find more African American history books, so if y'all got recommendations on that. And I'm not talking about, like, you know, a book written by African-American. I mean, like, the African-Americans of Harlem and stuff like that, because I've been reading books like that. Anyway, as you can see, I try to take this very seriously. With that being said, be out of here. Remember, the Eurasians going across Africa is very possible. As we brought out before, you know, it's very possible. We're reading about Wolof and stuff like that. The Fulani, these people do have Eurasian genes, showing that Eurasian gene flow did occur in sub-Saharan Africa. As David Reich said, the Eurasian farmers pretty much swept across sub-Saharan Africa. So when people have this claim, it is very possible.
It's possible. It's possible.
All right, we out, man. Yeah. Shout out to my Yap Mafia, man. Yap gang in the building. We will be back tomorrow. And we will be finishing. We finish our books around here. You heard me? Jersey.
I can't walk by faith. Every day I wake up to some brand new hate. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants up. It's on everybody top. All these stars that I welcome, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants up. It's on everybody top. I beat a case cause I wouldn't talk. You heard that side of the story, but that shit was false. The only ones that want revenge is the ones that lost. I got niggas mad at me cause I wouldn't cross. Solid as they come. You niggas ain't bust shit, how long you had that gun? Why I'm getting so much hate, I ain't mad at them. Fuck they feelings, now it's up, I throw a bag at them. Damn, had to turn my thug up. Had to put my love up. Cause I don't know who hate no more. They say I'm dead, I don't even wanna wait no more. I'm a stubborn. I can't walk by faith. Every day I wake up to some brand new hate. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants up. It's on everybody top. All these stars that I welcome, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants up. It's on everybody top.
My mama stopper. See my cousin dying, saw my face, I couldn't help. Your clothes on me, I'll try to backdoor you if you love them. I just sent the text 150 if you catch me. Strength. You ever been on the side of the barrel? You tell your shorties going slide, you gotta prep them on. And when you fall out with your brothers, just don't let them go. And they ain't telling before he died, I wish I let them know. Standing over your body, I got my tears together. I just let you know I got your kids forever. Taking all these drugs, wish I could live forever. ain't gon' even tell them what we did to go.
My mama stepping, I can't walk by faith. Every day I wake up to some brand new hate. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. On everybody top. All these stars that I welcome, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. It's on everybody top. Damn, had to turn my thug up. Had to put my love up. Cause I don't know who hate no more. They say I'm dead, I don't even wanna wait no more. All these stars that I welcome, most couldn't take. I got problems with some niggas cause I won't be fake. Every nigga ops, every nigga wants it's up. On everybody top.